I've been following in Martin's foot tracks in the commentary side, and I think this is definitely one of the more exciting seasons that we've had in Formula One. If you just look at the last race in Austria, we had three different manufacturers on the podium, and if you look at the fastest laps, they were all within a tenth of each other. I don't think it gets much better than that.
Okay, guys, listen up. What can you hear?
You can hear.
I think it's a Formula One engine. So, gentlemen, if you would like to take up your position, stand by. In 1 minute time, the parade through London begins. Start the countdown now.
10, position one.
Okay.
Yep, that's loud and clear for us.
Very good.
Very good, thanks for that. Yep.
10 now, please. G10 now.
Radio check.
1, 2, loud, clear.
And cool the car.
Remember the white line.
Yeah, no problem.
Yeah, okay, good. Loud and clear.
30 seconds max.
And radio check turn 8.
HPP 10, position 1. 10, position 1.
So the changes we've done our downshift test.
Well, good evening, everybody, and welcome to Trafalgar Square. DC, we're working together again.
Oh, it feels like we never separated, Martin. It's fantastic.
So we're going to see...
He's got wonderful cologne.
We are going to see quite an unusual mix of Formula One cars this evening. Some are going to sound somewhat better than others, completely different concepts over the decade. And in fact, the first one we see there warming up with René Arnoux at the wheel, the 1977 Renault RS01, the first turbocharged car in Formula One. Did you ever drive one of these, David?
No, I'm not quite as old as that, but incredible how this is what I think is so special about Formula One. Innovation that goes to the racetrack finds its way onto the cars that we have today. You know, we take for granted the turbocharged cars we can drive on the road, but this was groundbreaking technology at the time. It had much, much more power than the normally aspirated cars that they were competing against. But of course, as they were proving the technology, reliability was somewhat difficult. René Arnoux there, I was under the impression we were going to turn right out of the pit lane. Is that common for him that he may decide to turn left?
Well, I must say, I raced against René Arnoux. He was in Formula One until 1989. We didn't get on very well because we kept getting in each other's way. He would spoil one of my qualifying laps, so I'd pay him back. Because we didn't have stewards' decisions back then. It was just all sorted out on the racetrack. But he was a tough racer. These turbocharged cars, you had to put your foot on the throttle a good second before you needed any power. You had to anticipate them. Sadly, this was called the yellow teapot in the end, because it used to steam and smoke quite a lot.
Well, I can confirm that he did decide to go the wrong way around this racetrack. So, he's retirement makes parts for clocks, so maybe he prefers to go clockwise than anti-clockwise.
Well, he's used to being on the other side of the road, of course, being French, so I'm sure it felt absolutely natural for him. But what a beautiful-looking car.
Wonderful-looking car, and fantastic to see the fans of Formula One lining Whitehall here. An absolute first to have all of these different teams and cars represented. So as he heads into the pits, well, didn't smoke this time, and that was nice and safe.
We saw that car running around in Monaco earlier on the year. 149 starts for René Arnoux, 7 wins and 22 podiums. He was a handy driver, of course, and eventually Renault got it right with their turbocharged engines. But now then, we've got an altogether different offering. It's Stoffel Vandoorne, a 25-year-old who's had 9 starts in Formula One, the 2015 GP2 champion, of course. Scored a point in his debut Grand Prix in Bahrain last year, did Stoffel. And he is in the beautiful McLaren MP46 from 1991. A Honda V12 with a mere 700 horsepower.
Well, this takes me down memory lane because I won an award in 1991 for being an up-and-coming young driver. My prize was to drive this very car at Silverstone in 1992. So first experience was to drive Ayrton Senna's World Championship winning V12. But apparently Honda only made the V12 to prove to Ferrari that he also could have a winning 12-cylinder engine. Previously, of course, running with a V10.
It must have scared the life out of you, mustn't it, as a young driver?
It did. I remember calling my father before and he said, son, enjoy it and please don't crash.
So this car, a manual gearbox, of course. The drivers had to actually shift the cogs themselves. 8 wins and 10 pole positions. Gerhard Berger also drove it that year with the mighty Ayrton Senna. And, well, they've got enough steering law to get around. They're not London taxis, these cars, with such wide front tyres on them. They're really not easy to do a tight turn with at all, but they're just about getting away with it out there.
Yeah, I think this is a respectful display here from Stoffel. A lot of history in this car. A little bit of sliding the rear there just to help with the steering lock. And as he brings that back to the pits, well, you don't have to have been watching the television at that time to have a sense of occasion. And that's a truly special moment, having the opportunity to drive that Ayrton Senna World Championship car.
And how glorious does that V12 sound? And a pure car, a really classic colour scheme, of course. And, well, wouldn't it be nice if McLaren were up the front and challenging for championships these days? Let's hope they can return. And now then, we've got Pascal Wehrlein in the salvage, just 22 years old. He started 28 Grand Prix, best result of 8th and 6th World Championship points. German with a Mauritian mother, I believe, had an injury. I think you were there when Pascal was injured in the Race of Champions, David.
Yeah, he had an unfortunate and surprising incident where he came together with Felipe Massa in a race there. We have a competition in a stadium and he partially rolled the car and had some compression on his lower back. So he missed the first race due to that injury. Too much pain in that injury. But, you know, I think it's fantastic that Sauber have recognised this event by putting Hello London on the side of that Sauber car, and Pascal getting to grips with a V8.
Well, Formula One is very happy to be in the centre of London, and congratulations to you and your team, David, for putting this amazing event together, because it really does look spectacular out there. This is the Sauber C32 from 2013 with the Ferrari V8 engine. As you pointed out, and it had a bit of curves, a bit of electricity, right? I think that was intentional, don't you think? I think he meant to do that.
That was what you call a controlled turn, completely under control at all times. Yeah. And just adding a little bit of excitement to the crowd.
I think he couldn't be sure which way he wanted to go there. But driven in its day back in 2013 by Nico Hülkenberg and Esteban Gutierrez. It scored 57 points in that championship season, and I'm sure it had a few spins along the way as well. But Pascal, of course, is a young Mercedes driver, so he will be eyeing up a works Mercedes driver, he hopes, at some point in the future. But there he is in the Sauber. He's taken it somewhat more steady since that little moment.
Yeah, he's heading to the pit lane. He's decided that his two exploratory laps. There will be further running, of course, at the end of all of the single car runs. But nice touch there with the Union Jack being waved. And then look at that brilliant graphic there.
Some nice slow motion action. And, of course, these drivers all out at the British Grand Prix at Silverstone this weekend. And some more shots there of the Sauber C32. And a bit of a double donut, I think, we must be calling that. So next up, we've got Carlos Sainz in the Toro Rosso, young Spaniard who I think is destined for great things in Formula One, just 22 years old. 49 races on the board in Formula One. Best finish of 6th in a Grand Prix. Spanish, of course, his dad. He said, don't call me Carlos Jr., please. I know my dad's Carlos Sr. He is a world rally champion and a great man, a great sportsman. And as I say, I think this young man's going far, DC.
Well, you've been consistent on that. He's certainly made his intentions very clear, been very vocal recently that he wants to move on from this great feeder team, Toro Rosso, owned by the parent company, of course, Red Bull. And it has brought us some fantastic young drivers, Sebastian Vettel, of course, and Max Verstappen, Daniel Ricciardo, as examples of that. Toro, and for the Carlos, he really wants the chance to move on and get a car which may give him the opportunity to win. And just exploring again, another control turn there, beautifully managing to do that without too much fanfare.
It was the 2014 Renault 3.5 champ, 2011 Renault 2 litre champ. So got a couple of championships on his way up to Formula 1. Getting a bit frustrated, it must be said. He feels, you know, obviously Max Verstappen got moved up to the Red Bull team and left him behind. And they've taken up his option for next year. And he's like, I want to win races. I want to win the world championship. So despite only being 22 years of age, he wants to be moving on. But he's giving it some beans now in the Toro Rosso. Doesn't this sound glorious?
Yeah, it's, well, opinion is divided about exactly where we should be with Formula One in the future. Certainly the soundtrack from these normally aspirated multi-cylinder engines in comparison to the modern hybrids, there's obviously a lot more noise and beautiful control turn there as he makes his way back to the pit lane. But do you have a preference on the noise?
I think it's fairly easy, isn't it, really? Yeah, the V12s, V10s did it for me. The V8s I didn't like. At the time, I thought they were a little bit flat to drive, like they wouldn't pull the skin off a rice pudding, but I'd have them back in a heartbeat now. But I must say, having driven the latest hybrids, they are impressive pieces of kit. You've had a go as well.
Yeah, the torque that you get from the electrical energy, it just gives you a seamless acceleration. And this is a hybrid Formula One car, and the Williams 2004. This actually, 2014, excuse me, this was a pole position setting car in Austria of that year. So Williams in that season had had particularly good pace, and it was great to see on the images from the pit lane Claire Williams, deputy team principal of Williams, enjoying the event. She's pregnant, of course, and I wonder if she's going to have another little racing driver, male or female.
Just 18 years old, Lance Stroll, finished third in Azerbaijan, just lost second place on the line to Valtteri Bottas. What were you doing at 18, DC? Were you ready for F1?
Absolutely not. I think it's you know, a testament to the sort of programs, the junior programs that the drivers have today, which sees them more than prepared for Formula 1. And look at that fantastic helicopter shot above London. And I think the access that we've been given to be able to have Whitehall closed down, to have Trafalgar Square taken over, and to have that helicopter up in the air, and as he tries to gingerly find his way around.
I think he didn't want to give it a boot full, so he's playing by the rules there. It's the Williams FW36, and the Mercedes hybrid engine in that, of course. It's the car from 2014. Nine podiums, one pole position, 320 world championship points. This car scored with Felipe Massa and Valtteri Bottas at the wheel that year, and it moved Williams right back into contention towards the front of the grid. Lance, 2014 Italian F4 champion, 2015 Toyota Series champion, 2016 F3 Euro champion. He's done a lot in his 18 years, hasn't he? But certainly, you know, came into F1, looked like he was a bit out of his depth, learned quickly, moved on, and I have to say was one of the most impressive drivers in Azerbaijan, the whole event, and then ended up driver of the day.
Yeah, it was a great performance, and certainly a lot better than his ability to turn the car in a confined space.
Yeah, I hope he knows where reverse is again on this occasion. So, reverse gears on Formula One cars, hopeless little things, because you're not expected to use them too often. They're there for the regulations more than anything else. That's a very appropriate sign there, isn't it, really? Go on, Lance, give it some beans, and let's light up those rear tyres. But probably the first time he's driven through London in a Formula One car, I would guess.
Yeah, I think that is definitely the case, as he's going to head back into the pits. But, well, he certainly showed full respect to the circuit. Little wave of the hand there, acknowledging the great crowd and the fans of Formula One. Started.
Ferrari then, with Sebastian Vettel at the wheel, has fired up. We've got some Sebastian Vettel fans out this side of the track, that's for sure. And it's the 2015 Ferrari SF15T, a car. I've driven this exact car, actually, around Fiorano. And that was a privilege and a half. Oh, just beautiful. The Ferrari test track on a sunny day in this car. And green lights are on. We don't have green lights in Formula One anymore. Of course, we just wait because everybody realized that drivers were waiting for the red lights to begin to extinguish. They didn't pay any attention to the green light. So typical Formula One, we did away with the green light. Nothing, we don't carry any baggage in F1 if we can get away with it. So it's still got the tire blankets on. Are we going to go? Is the 30-year-old, the man who's made up 187 starts, some air plugs needed there by the looks of it. Great to see some young fans out in the streets. And 45 wins, 93 podiums, 2,279 world championship points, 47 pole positions. Can he drive round Trafalgar Square?
Well, my money says he certainly can. And, well, there's something special about a Ferrari taking to a road or a track. And look at him go. Fantastic acceleration as he heads down to the roundabout here, just behind our commentary booth.
Yeah, there he goes. What a wonderful sight. Look at that shot. Tremendous turnout here this evening. People getting to find out about the event and pretty much all of the grid here and pretty much all of the cars and teams too. It's a spectacular opening. And look at those rear tyres lighting up. You can tell that Sebastian Vettel doesn't pay for Ferrari's tyres as he spreads them around the London roads and heads once again down to Trafalgar Square. Go on, Seb.
Loving
the flowers.
See if you
can drift it all the way around there.
Can you see the flower pots there, Martin? Do you recognise any of that?
No. Have you been stuck in an Uber there or something?
Indeed. Well, Sebastian, that was a very nice control turn at the end of that particular run. He definitely wins the award for turning in comparison to Lance.
He's getting the hang of it. Yeah, he's definitely getting the hang of it. This car got one pole position and three wins, 16 podiums in 2015. Second in the constructors' title. And of course, it's just a 1600cc, 1.6 litre engine in those cars, but well over 900 horsepower with the battery pack as well. I think he's settled in for the evening, David.
He's having great fun, isn't he? He's really putting on a great show for those who are lining Whitehall. And, you know, Seb, he may not be active on social media, he may not be on Instagram personally, but he does recognise the fans. And again, another beautiful control turn there. And, well, 10 out of 10.
And that's not easy to do in a hybrid Formula One car at all, it must be said. So I think that's set the bar for the drivers who are to come along this evening. And let's just have a replay of that. A nice bit of slow-mo. How to donut a 900 horsepower Ferrari in a very confined space without getting into trouble. I wonder if anybody will actually hit that lamppost and keep left sign when they go right. And away it goes. Look at that, what a shot. The car's just gently going backwards, yet the rear wheels are doing 100 miles an hour.
Yeah, fantastic. Just dabbing the brake to do the perfect control turn.
And that went down well. That went down very, very well. And I think Natalie has found somebody to have a chat with.
In the two-seater, how was that?
Oh, it was great to be in front of the British crowd. So close. I've been having a luxury in the past to win in a British Grand Prix. So coming back so after so many years, be in front of them. But all the thanks, of course, goes to organizers, to London City, that way they are able to do something so unique middle of the London. So I enjoyed so much. And especially also because I'm here to giving the people the message to join the pact and never drink and drive. So campaign what we do in same time with the new stars of Formula One, and it's just a great what we can do together.
It It certainly is a very important pack to be part of. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
If we go over here, we can talk to a very strong role model in Formula One. Claire Williams, how are you?
I'm really well, thanks. How are you?
The bump is getting bigger. It's been kicking.
Yeah, the bump has been kicking ever since the cars have gone out. So, yeah, it's definitely a Williams.
Those V10s really fire everyone up, don't they? Just to tell us why Williams have got behind this event and why it's so important to Great Britain and motorsport in this country.
This is just brilliant. I've been here all afternoon, and just to see all the activity going on in the square, and then to come and have all the drivers here, just have like pretty much every F1 driver with all our cars. It's just fantastic. And to bring it to London, where you know 8 out of the 10 teams are based in the UK, so this feels like it's just such a special event ahead of the Grand Prix this weekend.
Now, last time out, both your drivers made 8 places up each, because I spoke to them after qualifying and they were both pretty miserable because quali didn't go well. But then they both finished in the points. This was a great race.
It was a great race for us, and one we didn't really expect after having had quite a difficult weekend. It was just a total anomaly, really. We didn't understand what the issues were. And then during the race, obviously, the guys made a great start. They managed to benefit from some drivers going off. But hey, we were still in it, and we got our points, which is fantastic.
And last night was a very special occasion for you and the Williams family. Just tell us about it.
Yeah, so we launched the Williams film documentary last night, which is the real story behind Williams. It's not a chronological tale of our team. It's a real human, aspirational story behind Williams and my parents' role in it. And, you know, it was a really proud moment for me and just a really nice evening.
Great stuff. Thanks very much, Claire. Right, let's go back to Martin and DC.
Thanks, Pinky. DC, we were both teammates of Mika Häkkinen, a man who doesn't use two words when one will do, but what a fast driver he was.
Yeah, incredible speed, very consistent, and he won his world championships against the great Michael Schumacher, and we know how good he was.
So who wants to see Daniel Ricciardo? Anybody out there ready for Daniel Ricciardo? The smiling Aussie, he's already giving it plenty as he appeared to reverse out of the garage there almost. So the man with the shoey, and I can tell you, I don't like the taste of warm, sweaty champagne. You dumped it in Azerbaijan. You didn't drink the shoey, DC.
Well, I felt, you know, with Lance getting his first podium, it was the opportunity to allow him to experience that. But listen to the V8 engine. Wow, that noise is music to my ears.
That's going to be setting car alarms off everywhere in the city, I'd imagine. 28 years old, Daniel Ricciardo. The flip-top smile, always a good man to meet up with in the paddock, on the podium, anywhere. What you see is what you get with this great Aussie driver. Just the two, let's go into a third. Can we do 4? Next time around, maybe. So this is the Red Bull RB7, 2011, 2.4-litre V8 Renault. Revving to 18,000 revs. Check the rev counter on your road car next time you get in it and imagine 18,000 of them. So 12 wins, 27 podiums, 18 pole positions. This is one successful racing car.
It was a fantastic car. It was a fantastic era for Formula One. And Daniel there really exploiting all of the traction that the Grand Prix car can deliver and putting on a great show, it has to be said, for those that are lining. And this is another opportunity to do a little controlled turn. Yes, beautifully, right in the middle of the pit-out area there. Well, is that 3? Is he going for a 4th?
When you've got limited steering lock, you have to use that particular style of turning, don't you think?
Oh, I do. Yeah, fantastically under control.
Going to wipe the rear wing out there, but he got it absolutely. Now, you've done many a show in this car around the world, haven't you, David?
I have, and it's always great to be able to take a car into the city and to the race fans, and I think, you know, that was, we can agree, I think that's been the best run so far. Beautiful driving.
We certainly enjoyed it, and we'll pretend we didn't like the 2.4-litre V8 in that, shall we? And so that was a world championship car for both driver and team, was the RB7 in 2011.
That was a brave entry, wasn't it? That was straight out of the pit lane, into a control turn, and off you go. So there's a man who's confident in his own capabilities.
Yeah, that almost deserves scores like in ice skating or something like that, because I think it was a grand entrance. And as you say, comfortably on pole position at the moment is the young Aussie.
You know what's been really great, Martin, is we just see some fantastic slow-mos from the heli shot. To see the camaraderie amongst the drivers. You know, they've been sharing a green room, getting changed together, getting ready to come out and celebrate this opportunity, taking pictures of the cars on the track. We don't see that at a Grand Prix, do we?
We don't, but it's only Wednesday, remember. Let's see how they are on Thursday evening. So next up, then, Valtteri Bottas, the man who won last Sunday at the Austrian Grand Prix, 27 years old, a couple of wins under his belt, and he's sneaking right up in the world championship contention, isn't he?
Fantastic drive, fantastic driver, and you can see him growing in confidence, quietly working away in Mercedes under a one-year contract, so the uncertainty of knowing whether they have a second year with them, but with performances like we saw in Austria, I don't think we'll doubt that he'll be re-signed.
Oh, that's going to be very close. Oh, I thought he was going into a donut there. I'm pleased he didn't. So 16 wins this Mercedes W06, 32 podiums. And 18 pole positions, 700 world championship points in one season from one team. That's how good this car was, and what a pleasure it is to see it in the centre of London and working.
I think he did do a little controlled turn just in front of the pit lane, and you know, with some fantastic camera shots from the cockpit there, it makes it look so much faster when you can see. And here he's just stopping to acknowledge the crowd. He's recognised a fan and a friend, and therefore showing how to make the perfect start, which he did, of course, in Austria.
Absolutely, yes, it was so perfect, people questioned it, but I think he got lucky on that one, frankly. It was a brilliant start, but he's going to have a go the other way around now. Sure, he's in control.
He's having a spinning time, isn't he?
But then you end up in a cloud of your own acrid Pirelli smoke, don't you?
Yeah, but this man has skills. He got it under control and entered safely back into his pit box.
It's like they can't work out where the garage is when they get down there. They just keep turning around, having a look at it. So now we've got Jenson Button and Naomi Campbell in the two-seater, the F1 experience. Two-seater, and Natalie is standing by down there.
Okay, so I'm down here in amongst the fans. What have you enjoyed today? That was a bit of fun seeing some donuts, wasn't it?
Just the whole thing, it's been incredible. And actually seeing all the drivers stood up and watching it and seeing how engaged they were, they loved it. They were so excited as us, so that was fantastic to see.
And do you have a favourite driver?
Vettel, yeah. He's my hero. So much better than Hamilton.
Going to get a bad reaction around here. Who's your favourite driver?
Same, mine is Vettel as well.
Listen, he's within touching distance, isn't
he? Yeah, amazing.
It's been good fun, hasn't it? And highlight for you so far?
Ricardo just now, incredible, just brilliant, absolutely great.
Do you regret in a way that the engines have changed? Because they're the old engines, make the old ribs rattle, don't they?
No, they don't sound the same at all. It's, the older ones sounded much better for sure.
And what about the British Grand Prix this weekend? Who's going to win it?
I think Hamilton will. Hamilton will win it.
And the championship itself?
Vettel.
Mercedes can't decide who's going to be their number one. Vettel.
What about you? Who's your favourite driver?
Probably Hamilton, just because British.
Absolutely. Now, is he going to win the race this weekend?
Hopefully, but it could go either way, him or Vettel.
Good stuff. Okay, a car's about to come back up on track.
So what's happening here? Very capable hands of Jenson Button. He said it's as a two-seater, he's a bit tight in there. The steering wheel's in his chest.
Well, Naomi Campbell cuddled up behind him. That's not something that happens every day.
So, JB taking it very cautiously. What they're doing is bringing the British Grand Prix trophy up to the stage here in the F1 two-seater. And there it is, and a certain Mr. Damon Hill. How did they get that in there? It's the real thing as well. I thought it might be like a
that
two-dimensional
has a lot
car
of value.
Thing.
No, and you know, fair play to Damon for really joining the spirit of this celebration. Look at him holding that trophy like he did back in the day. He's very proud.
Got the eye cam there.
I'm going to have to work on my eyelashes, I think. That was a beautiful scene. And then there, JB going for a half spin.
JB. Farewell. He stalled it out. And anybody out there can give that car a push for us. And JB there, he's getting a bit rusty in his old age.
Well, in many ways, while Jensen Button clears his car, this is the perfect moment, ladies and gentlemen. Please welcome to the stage not only Damon Hill, but the British Grand Prix Winners Trophy. Overplay it, you know.
Yeah.
Play it down.
Perfectly down.
How incredible has it been watching those cars out there, both the classic cars from the 70s that Julian was driving, the modern cars as well, and the skill of the drivers keeping them on the tarmac?
Yeah, a little bit nerve-wracking, isn't it, when you're watching them going around, but these guys are the best drivers in the world, so nothing to fear. And what a brilliant sound, some of those cars, the different noises. It's a great display. It's been a brilliant day, I think.
And David, who do you think is going to be lifting that trophy there on Sunday?
Well, there's one person who's not... Oh, can you hear me? There's one person who's not here that hasn't made an appearance, but I think that that person might well be a potential holder of the trophy. And I think if we all close our eyes and say, we believe, I think it just might happen that Lewis Hamilton will win the British Grand Prix.
That's rather...
What about that?
A popular choice, I'm sure.
They're happy about that.
Damon, thank you very much for bringing the trophy up. Let's have a quick word with our commentary team while we take a look at the replays of the cars out on track and things. You've commentated since you retired in Formula One in the late 90s on lots of huge moments in the sport. Nothing ever quite like that, though.
No, to see Formula One cars donutting on a summer's evening around Monaco. None of them have read the script as to which way to turn and where to do the donuts. They're all like, we've got an eight-car parade coming up, I believe, next. That's going to be horrific. I hope they all follow each other and go the same way around Trafalgar Square. Really pleased. It's a fabulous evening.
And I suppose one of the things that you do when you're an amazing driver is you make it look easy. Those guys have made it look easy, but you've done plenty of these show car runs around the world. How hard is it to control a Formula One car of that kind of power in a donut that close to crowds?
Well, of course, it is a little bit more tricky than you would be the case in a full open road course. But, you know, safety was paramount here. They were all well briefed. Some were a little bit more enthusiastic than others, but I think we've got some great images. And, you know, a heli shot looking down on a Grand Prix car with Trafalgar Square and Nelson's Column and all of the great iconic images of London. For me, I feel emotional. And, you know, the only way it could maybe be better would be if we were up there in that super VIP area in the National Gallery sipping champagne.
Do you need a cuddle?
Yeah,
come on. Hug it out. Hug out the emotion. Gentlemen, thank you very much. Let's go back to the middle. So, Roche, look, those guys have raced in Formula One. I've had the pleasure to host it.
Yes.
What's it like for you seeing those cars today?
For me, it's just super impressive. You know, I'm not like you. I don't know everything all Formula One. But I'm here to enjoy the day. And what a fantastic day it's been, right? And we're not finished. We're not finished yet.
Absolutely we're not. Because in a moment, we're going to have the eight-car parade, as David mentioned. All the cars hopefully behaving and driving alongside each other, not messing around too much. But I think for Formula One, for the guys that have put this event on, I think a round of applause.
Absolutely.
For the Mayor of London, for all the people that have organised this, the teams, the drivers, everyone that's made F1 Live come together in London today, because trust me, you have seen something quite remarkable.
Absolutely.
And as Rochelle says, it's not over yet, gentlemen, it's time for the parade.
It is indeed. And it's all the cars you've seen so far running for a second time. And we have Seb Vettel out there, I believe, Kimi Raikkonen, Max Verstappen, and Lance Stroll, Daniel Kvyat, Marcus Ericsson. Maybe Stoffel Vandoorne again. Fernando wasn't sure whether he was going to drive or not. I think not. He said he wanted a deck chair. He'd rather sit in a deck chair and watch the proceedings for some reason. So we'll see if we see Fernando out there. And then, of course, Julian Palmer is going to be in the 1977 Renault.
Well, as you were reading that, Martin, I was getting concerned that Naomi was permanently stuck to Jensen there. She was and pretty up close and personal, but I did see some air come between them. So, but I think that would have been a special experience for her to feel the horsepower of a Grand Prix car with a former Grand Prix world champion.
She'll be scolding him for stalling the engine mid-donut, as you do.
Well, you don't want to cross. No,
we've all done it. We've all done it. Try to show off to a pretty girl and make yourself look a fool.
I don't remember.
Are you sure? There we go. So away comes the Mercedes then, rather rapidly.
Oh, his starts have been incredible, haven't they?
They have been incredible. Once again, he's out really early. He's getting away. It's the new technique in Formula One. So, let's see then. In the Mercedes Benz, expecting Kimi to be in the Ferrari, which of course it is. We've got Max Verstappen, the teenage sensation, the young Dutchman, the man who can already fill grandstands all around the world in his teens. Is he having a miserable season of all? 5 retirements in the last 7 races for Max Verstappen in the Red Bull. 1 contact in Spain and some gremlins with the car. And this is going to get properly noisy and lots of energy. So 8 cars out there. You're looking at something around 6,000 horsepower, I quickly guesstimate, around up Whitehall and around Trafalgar Square.
Well, you're the brains of this organisation, so I'm not going to question that. So I'll go with 6,000.
It sounds about right. So there goes the Ferrari. Oh, man, I wish I'd have driven for Ferrari. I've driven 3 or 4 of them since for television, but something about the scarlet colour of the Ferrari and everything Ferrari stands for. And there's Valtteri practicing his getaway for Silverstone at the weekend. I think that was his start for the British Grand Prix, actually.
You've got to get the practice when you can.
You have, but indeed. Marcus Ericsson's in the Sauber. And I think it'll be Stoffel. We haven't seen the McLaren MP4-6. As I say, all the cars you've seen in Run 1 just coming out as a full parade. Wish you were out there, DC.
You know, I enjoyed my time in Formula 1. It was a great period, but this is the next generation's time. And it's a privilege to be able to know that a sport that we love, that we put so much of our life, our hearts all into, to have the chance for it to be celebrated in a great city like London. It's just a fantastic
experience. Here we go. Jolyon Palmer then joins the track for the first time in the 1977 Renault. And just to remind you about that car, the RS01, the first turbocharged Formula One car there ever was. And they laughed at Renault in the beginning, and Renault had the last laugh some years later.
Well, the streets are alive with the sound of Formula One music. And then it went silent.
How do you feel, David? Because you put an awful lot of work with Guy Horner and Velocity into making this event happen, and along with Formula One management.
Well, you know, I think it's a great day to see that there's a real vision to bring Formula One closer to the fans, to increase the fan experience, and this is the first of delivering, and having delivered very quickly in the new ownership, bringing it, and I don't think you can say you can get much closer than that to a Formula One car. Not even in Monte Carlo can you get that close to an active Grand Prix car.
No, it's a bit like the hairpin in Monte Carlo, actually. They're all queuing up, waiting their turn to show off, basically. And burn up some Formula One rubber as they head around the track. What an eclectic mix of cars, actually, from the latest hybrids to the earliest turbos 40 years ago. And the Toro Rosso there with Daniel Kvyat at the wheel, the young Russian. And he can be very exciting. He gets a bit too exciting sometimes, doesn't he? He has had a bit of contact, not least last weekend when he wrote Fernando Alonso off, and of course the famous one up against Seb Vettel in Russia twice last year. But he's a very quick little driver on his day as well.
Yeah, he is, and you know, a little bit unfortunate maybe at the start of that Grand Prix, error of judgment. When you think about it, when you highlight the fact he's rear-ended two of the greatest and most successful drivers in current Formula One, and Fernando Alonso and Sebastian
Vettel.
They were
a bit slow on the day.
Well, no, I wasn't going to say that, but you see Valtteri there. Jose's blue eyes, he's decided to park the car.
23 years old, Kvyat, and 66 Formula One races under his belt. I thought there was a yellow flag. There is a yellow flag waving there for a stalled car, probably an overheated car.
Yeah, that's Valtteri who's decided to park it. And we've got Toro Rosso that's run out of room, so he's going to need a little push back.
You need to know that Formula One cars have no fans on them at all. They only get cooled by passing through the air, so they really don't like putting a lot of power out, spinning wheels, and no air going through the car. And that is when they quickly overheat and decide they want to play no further power in proceedings. They are designed to do 200 miles an hour at Silverstone, 210, 220 at some circuits. That's where they feel right, where they're best designed for, and not trundling down Whitehall. There's Valtteri then, waving.